Before I talk about what I want to discuss in the main in this lecture, what Jesus intended and what the supper really meant to the apostles as they reflected upon it, I want to say a word on the real presence. When I began to give this lecture some years ago, it soon became clear to me that I needed to make it very clear that I accepted the real presence in the Eucharist. There's an impression around for some people that theologians are watering down the real presence, are not happy to affirm our faith in the real presence. Well, I affirm our faith in the real presence. The faith of the church from the beginnings, from the time of St. Paul and the apostles, was that what was bread and wine placed on the altar becomes real body and blood of the Lord. In the church, there's absolutely no question of the church ever renouncing that faith in the real presence. The council wanted to bring a balance. I'll try to explain how there needed to be a balance in this matter. To do that, the council reminded us that there are many ways in which Jesus, our Saviour, is present in the liturgy. The expression real presence, if you think about it, is an unusual expression, isn't it? Presence is normally real. So how did this emphasis come about whereby we have so insistently spoken of the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist? Well, the council, in taking up that question, reminds us that Christ is present in many ways, not the same ways, not the Eucharistic presence, but a real presence. The council says he's present in the community. Where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I in their midst. Is that a real presence? Certainly. The Saviour is with us. We can turn to him. We are united in him. We are gathered around him. But it's not the Eucharistic presence. But it's a very important presence in the life of the church. And then there's his presence, the council says, in the scriptures. Whenever we read the scriptures, we end with that proclamation, the word of the Lord. There's only one word of the Lord, the eternal word, the word of the Father, the Son who came forth from the Father, the full expression of all that the Father is. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So in the scriptures, Jesus, the truth that he is, all that he is in his divine truth, finds expression. So in some way, he is truly present in the scriptures. The word of the Lord. It's not the Eucharistic presence, but it's a real presence. Then there's the presence of Christ, the council says, in the pastoral ministry of the church. He who hears you, hears me. If we want to know God's ways, if we want to respond to the call of God, if we want to really have that faith to which God calls us, we must listen, we must be open. The church nourishes us. The church guides us. The faith is lived on through the church. If we try to go it alone without following the church and be faithful and loyal and loving to the church, we'll lose our way. So that Christ, he who hears you, hears me. Christ is present. And then the council said, he's present in the sacraments. It quotes St. Augustine. St. Augustine said, it doesn't matter whether it is Judas who baptizes or Peter who baptizes, it's really Christ who baptizes. The sacraments are Christ's actions. They are divine actions in our midst in which we are gathered in to share in the Paschal mystery, share in what was achieved by God in the final great act of the death and resurrection of Jesus, bringing forth a new humanity. So that Christ is active in all the sacraments. But then the council concludes he is especially present in the Eucharistic sacrament. So there's a unique manner of presence in the Eucharistic sacrament, but we need to bear in mind, if we're going to renew the liturgy, these other manners of his presence. and relate to him and worship him and be united to him in those presences. How did the imbalance that I spoke of come about? History is a great teacher. As I was teaching theology, I constantly found that if you can explain how Christian thought developed down through the ages and led us to our present situation, a lot of our problems and our questions are greatly clarified for us. See, Jesus didn't give us in the Eucharist a thing, he gave us an action. Do this. Take and eat. Take and drink. That is the Eucharist. He calls us to share in that action. That is the Eucharist, our sharing in the Eucharistic liturgy, sharing in the Mass. From the early church, after Mass was celebrated, the Eucharist was reserved. It was kept. Why was it kept? Not to be venerated. That wasn't the purpose. It was kept that it might be the food of those who were dying, the viaticum, wonderful way in which people are set on their journey into eternity, receiving the bread of life. So that was a very early custom in the church, and the sacrament was preserved for that. Different customs developed in the Eastern and Western churches. In the Eastern Church, and still the same today, there are many traditions in the Eastern churches, the Eucharist is preserved in the sacristy, in a special press or cupboard, but it's not adverted to unless it is required for viaticum. So that they don't have our tradition of venerating the reserved sacrament. They concentrate all their Eucharistic awareness on the celebration of the mysteries, as they call the Mass, the Eucharistic sacrifice. So in the West, a different custom developed. The sacrament, a very obvious one. The sacrament was preserved in a special place in the church. The very early tabernacles were movable pieces of furniture. One early tabernacle was like a silver bird, and it could be opened, and the Eucharist was put in it. It was on chains, and when the Eucharist was put in it, it was put up into the right up into the ceiling of the church. Very obviously, people tended to put the Eucharist in a more and more honourable position until we had what we took for granted in our time, the tabernacle in the most honoured place in the church. That custom of reservation developed. The emphasis on the real presence probably echoes a controversy in the 12th century. In the 12th century, the church has not long come out of the Dark Ages. The church came into existence in the Roman Empire, and the Roman Empire was disintegrating even in the time of Christ. And so by the 6th century, the Roman Empire was collapsing. The organization of Europe, the Roman Empire, was beginning to be ineffectual. So Europe then slipped into a period of chaos and lawlessness that we call the Dark Ages. A time when organization of the church and of society in general was very difficult. Scholarship was neglected. The monks preserved all the resources of our tradition in their monasteries, but there were no universities, no centers of study, except within the monasteries themselves. It was only after the Dark Ages ended the medieval universities emerged. And then scholarship began again. And a man named Berengarius in the 12th century read the writings of St. Augustine on the sacraments. St. Augustine stresses the symbolic aspect of the sacraments. Sacraments are symbols. They're signs and symbols. A symbol is a special sign, a sign that's rich in meaning, a sign that suggests many things, leads us to meditate. The dawn, for example, is symbolic. The moment when the sun is rising and the whole earth is coming alive again is a very symbolic moment. It's a time of reflection. It's a time that suggests the beginning of a new day, has many, many overtones. A symbol is rich in meaning and invites meditation and contemplation. Augustine loved to discuss the sacraments in that way. We die and rise with Christ, the oil, the water, and so forth. All of these things were interpreted in a symbolic way to bring out the richness of our sacramental life and liturgical life. So Berenger is reading this, wrote a treatise on the Eucharist, suggesting that the Eucharist may be merely a symbol of our Lord's body and blood, not the real body and blood. Europe rose up in outrage. Clearly, the whole of Europe was united in the faith that the bread and wine had been changed to the real body and blood of the Lord. It was clear that Berengarius was denying the living faith of the Church. Berengarius soon withdrew what he had to say and really changed his mind about it, because it was clear that the witness of the Church was without doubt. It's very interesting in questions like this to go back to see how the Eastern and Western churches are united in these fundamental things of the faith. You know that the Eastern Church and the Western Church went into schism. They broke their communion about the year 1000. And if you find that the Eastern and Western churches are absolutely one in faith, we know that takes us back to the early centuries of the Church. Well, this is certainly the case. Just as truly as we believe in the real body and blood of the Lord given to us in the sacraments, so too do the Eastern churches. Berengarius helped to bring out a reaffirmation of the Church of faith, and probably our emphasis on the real presence comes from that time, because the real presence is as opposed to symbolic presence, not a symbolic presence, but a real presence. Now, as I said, the Eucharist was preserved in the Church, and this gave rise in our Western Church to a wonderful tradition of devotion. Venerating the Blessed Sacrament, reserved, it's not part of the Church's liturgy. It is a devotion, is alongside the liturgy. During the Dark Ages, you can understand in that time of lawlessness, it's almost miraculous that the Christian Church survived such a chaotic period. Communication was very poor, organization was very, very difficult, the formation of the clergy was extremely inadequate, and during that time, the Eucharistic practice of the Church got out of balance. Many people did not go to communion at all. So in the beginning of the 13th century, we had the canon law of the Easter communion. It's a strange law, isn't it? You must go to communion at least once a year. God has given us this wonderful blessing, and they have to have a law that people will avail themselves at least once a year of that blessing, because people were not going to communion at all. Many people thought, it was a popular opinion, that the main thing about going to Mass was to see the host raised. That was the most important thing about Mass. So you can see how veneration, reverence for the sacrament, is displacing participation. Do this. Take and eat. Take and drink. Our Lord's own invitation has been forgotten. And now the Eucharistic emphasis has moved off in another direction. It was during this time that the monstrance appeared, the monstrance whereby the Blessed Sacrament could be displayed for veneration. Benediction emerged at this same time. Eucharistic processions became very common. So you can see how people's awareness of the Eucharist now has really moved away from the centre to something that is peripheral. It's interesting to look back, even within my own lifetime, on the Church's Eucharistic life. When I was a child, even when I was a seminarian, benediction was far more solemn than Mass. Never have benediction without a set number of, I think 12 candles you had to have, flowers, music, incense. Never have benediction without incense and music, hymns, Mass, 2 candles, no hymns. There's something gone wrong, hasn't it? The Mass is infinitely more important than benediction. Do this. take and eat, take and drink. They're the Lord's words. So something had got out of kilter in that way in which the Eucharistic life was being lived. And I'm sure that the Protestant reluctant to believe in the Eucharist in the great standoff of the Reformation, and I'm sure that was in part due to the imbalance that they saw. They said, but this is not what Jesus gave. Let me conclude this bit on the real presence by just speaking of the way in which we should express the real presence. We've got to use the right terms and the right thought forms, the right categories. I've heard people say, Christ is physically present in the Eucharist. Well, that's not true. It's not the right term to use. Physical presence, the word physical comes from the Greek word for nature. So a physical presence is a presence that is a presence through the natural characteristics of the thing. I'm physically present here. You can see me, you can hear me, you can come and touch me if you like, and you know that I'm here. It's through my natural characteristics. In the Eucharist, we know Jesus is not present through his natural characteristic. He's present under the appearance of bread and wine, the species, the Latin word for appearances, is what we've used down through the ages. His real body is present, but it's present in this mysterious sacramental way that's possible only to God. It's this tradition on the Eucharist, going right back, there are some wonderful passages in the Fathers of the Church on the real presence in the Eucharist. And they take up the challenge. They say, how can this be? How can this bread and wine become the body and blood of the Lord? They don't back away from the question. They face that question and the challenge, even the Jews in the time of Jesus and those who walked no longer with him. And their answer was, well, God created the world out of nothing, didn't he? Surely it is possible to him, though we cannot understand it and we believe it, we know it on his word, that this is truly the body and blood of the Lord. We've got to use the right thought forms. Christ is not physically present. We say he's sacramentally present. It is a unique kind of presence. Let's now come to the main part, which I want to recapture the experience of the apostles at the Last Supper. Before I begin that, it's well to reflect on what rituals are. Rituals are very important in human life. There's some things that we do, some occasions, some practices that are so important, so meaningful, so deep, that we develop a special ritual for them. If we didn't have those rituals, we'd have to invent each time we celebrated a birthday or did something like that, a way of expressing what it meant for us. So these rituals are very, very important in our life. They help us to enter deeply into the important things of life because they aid us and give us a symbolic way of doing that. I'll give you a very simple example. We have a strange ritual, shaking hands. It's rather strange, isn't it? I believe it began in the Middle Ages when two men met, they would give one another their weapon hands so there'd be no treachery. They could trust one another while they were holding one another's weapon hands. Well, it's developed from that into a very, very meaningful symbol. Like shaking hands is so simple, yet it's possible to express in many, many ways what exactly the meeting means to us. It's all important that it remain alive. See, rituals can die, can't they? You've all had the dead fish. Do what you like with it and he takes it back. It's lost all its meaning. So the renewal of the liturgy, it's very important for us to find the meaning of the rituals and to find how we can put life into them, how we can enter into those rituals. That's really part of the renewal of the liturgy. So I think that recovering the moment of the supper can help us to understand how we can participate, how we can enter into, how we can respond to what Jesus intended when he gave us the Eucharist. So let's recreate that moment. It was a moment of table fellowship. Table fellowship was very important in the life of Jesus. As we have recalled, the insult that was thrown at him was that he liked to drink and a good meal, that he liked to party, a wine bibber and a glutton, they said, those who were unfriendly to him. So clearly, sitting down at a table with friends was something that he enjoyed, something he entered into, and parties are very good things, aren't they? They're a moment of fellowship and togetherness that is without compare in our human life. In the Oriental culture that he lived in, table fellowship was very important. And for many, many peoples, table fellowship is important, almost a sacred thing. If you're invited to someone's table, that's a sign of fellowship, trust, common cause, genuine friendship, and there's something sacred in that. So in the Middle East, this sacredness of table fellowship was developed by the Jewish people in their prayers. Devout Jewish people had prayers at table, and Jesus was a devout Jew, and he had gathered around him his followers as his new family, and he led them in prayer. The prayer that of the Jewish table fellowship was a prayer of blessing. But notice it wasn't the food that was blessed, it was God that was blessed. We have echoes of that in the Gospel account of the Eucharist. He gave thanks and praise, and also in some of the different incidents, the multiplication of the loaves and the fishes. He gave thanks and praise. God is blessed. The Jewish people, when they saw on their table their daily bread, remembered all the blessings that God had given them, they thanked God, they blessed God. Well, it's unfortunate our blessing is really the end of the monastic grace. The monastic grace began with hymns of praise, praising God for his blessings and all that we've received. Then it ended with this little prayer, bless us and the food we're about to receive. But we kept that little prayer and we left out the main thing that was the thanks and praise of God. So Jesus led his people in thanks and praise. In his own life, at table, he had performed different symbolic actions. The marriage feast of Cana, the change of the water into wine, the receiving of the sinful woman, the washing of the feet. There you have instances where Jesus did something symbolic at table. So it wasn't unknown to them that he should do something unexpected. The Jews had the daily prayers of thanks and praise. They had a more elaborate prayer of thanks and praise on the Sabbath day. And then at the Passover celebration, they had their most solemn thanks and praise. And this Passover was the central ritual of the Jewish year. I think one of the reasons the Jewish tradition has lived on so tenaciously is the wonderful domestic liturgies that they have, the customs of prayer in the family. And this Passover meal is the outstanding example of that. It's a meal carried on in the family. It's the head of the family who presides, and it's carried on each year. Everyone knows its ritual, a wonderful ritual that commemorates their coming out of slavery in Egypt. It's a commemoration of the foundational event of Israel's life. God, the champion of their freedom, had seen them in their misery and slavery and was leading them forth under Moses, the prophet, in the name of God who was leading them forth. So they're celebrating that Exodus, that Passover, into freedom. It was a time in which they remembered all that God had done. And there was a vivid realism about it because they believed that the God who had led his people out into freedom was the same God who was now with them, the living God. And they truly believed they had the same blessings as those first people who were led out. So there was a great sense of God's presence and realism. And there was a great sense of expectation. Many Jews at the time of Jesus believed that on the night of the Passover, the Messiah would appear. But we've said several times, the whole faith of Israel was filled with expectation. The great plan of God's going forward to come to its climax in the Saviour, the Messiah, the anointed one of God. It's not surprising that this expectation was very vivid, that the Messiah would appear on the night of the Passover. The apostles certainly were aware of that. So imagine the prayer that Jesus led them in prayer of thanks to God, wonder before God, vivid expectation of God's blessings. They've come to believe that he is the Messiah. He is the one through whom God's blessings, final blessings and final achievement will come. They expect in some way, through him, this is to happen. They must have been with him with expectation, wonder, and hope in their minds as they shared the meal with him. It's also a farewell meal. So this adds another dimension. But this Passover meal is the last meal, probably, they will ever have with him. They've come to Jerusalem under protest. Jesus spent all his time in Galilee. He rarely went to Jerusalem. He came down for the different festivals. He's hardly recognized there. We see this quite clearly in the evidence of the gospel. But people have heard of him. They're wondering about him. His enemies are determined to destroy him. That is their place of power. And coming to Jerusalem was fatal for Jesus. In the gospel account, there are many echoes of this atmosphere. They're talking about betrayal. They're protesting they'll be faithful, even if they have to die with him. They're even talking about the weapons to defend themselves. They have two swords. This added a new dimension to the Passover meal. The Passover meal is structured like this. It began with hors d'oeuvre, a bitter herbs dipped into salty sauce. And they were chewed as a reminder of the slavery that they had experienced. And after that beginning and the blessing of the first cup of wine, the youngest person at the table said, "What is the meaning of this night?" Then the father explains, the head of the family explains the meaning of the night, how they've been freed from slavery, the wine, the expression of their joy, the unleavened bread they left in haste, the paschal lamb they are going to eat. The blood of the lamb was on the doorpost to mark them out as God's people, to be preserved from the pestilences that were coming. All the elements of the meal were explained. And when that first part of the meal was finished, they then moved into the main part of the meal, which was the eating of the paschal lamb. That eating of the paschal lamb was framed between two very solemn rituals. One was the blessing and eating of the unleavened bread. Then after the eating of the paschal lamb, the blessing and drinking of the cup of wine. It's clear that Jesus used those two moments to give us the Eucharist. You've got an echo of it in the account. At the end of the meal, he took the cup. They've left out reference to the paschal lamb, and they've just made reference to the taking of the bread and the taking of the wine. So in this atmosphere that we've recreated, Jesus makes his gesture, gives us his final gift. He takes the unleavened bread and says, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you." And he takes the cup, "Take and drink. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for the people." Very deliberate words. "My blood of the covenant." He echoes the words of Moses when the first covenant was established at Mount Sinai with great sacrifices. Moses took the blood of the animals. And of course, in the scriptures, blood is not a sign of violence, but it's a sign of sacredness and life. And the blood is to be the bond between the people and God. So the blood is sprinkled on the altar, it stands for God, sprinkled on the book of the covenant, sprinkled on the people. And they're united in the covenant, united through the blood. Jesus says, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for the people, poured out for the multitude." Those are the words of the suffering servant in the Isaiah writings. Suffering servant at the time of the exile. Those wonderful hymns that we have. Remember the one on Good Friday, the absolutely magnificent hymn. "The one who bore our burdens, by his wounds we have been healed. He's brought healing to the whole world." The servant is Israel, but it's foreshadowed that someone, somehow, will fulfill the great destiny of Israel, and that is Jesus is fulfilling that destiny. Remember, the kings of the earth are all gathered around at the servant, and suddenly they're struck dumb because they come to realize that the servant, Israel, in suffering and captivity, is going to bring blessings on the whole world. By failure and suffering, God can bring forth his great plan. Jesus identifies with the suffering servant. Now, what was the meaning of his gesture? Why did he give us this sacrament, in which St. Paul says, "We proclaim his death until he comes"? Clearly, it expresses his death. The separation of the bread and the wine is symbolic of his dying. He gives us a sacrament that we may share in this coming moment of his death. Dying should be the greatest act of our living. It's a wonderful privilege a priest sometimes has of accompanying people who are dying and coming to making the journey with them. And very often, it's a wonderful experience because those people find reconciliation. They're reconciled to themselves. They're reconciled to their lives. They look back and they make whatever changes need to be made, whatever repentance, whatever prayers and thanksgiving has to be made. They come to terms with their life and they're reconciled with their God. And they're ready to give themselves and all they are, their whole life, into the hands of God. Now, if that's true of an ordinary human being, it was certainly true of Jesus. In his death, he gave back into the hands of his Father all that he was. His whole life lived together with us. The life that he shared with us in this dark and broken, lost, selfish world. He would give back into the hands of his Father his whole ministry. His whole struggle, all that he had done, his whole love for the world, everything, all that he is, he gives back into the hands of his Father. It's a perfect gift coming from the depth of our world, in our flesh and blood. And that gift is received by the Father. And that reception is the resurrection. The Father receives the gift, and Jesus is vindicated. He places himself in his Father's hands, and the Father vindicates him. The Father glorifies him, and the Father brings forth, through the power of the Spirit, the final achievement of the great plan of God for creation, the new humanity in the risen Christ. In that moment, he gathers up all that he is for the sake of the world. All that he's done in obedience and love of his Father, he now gives back into the hands of his Father, and he would like us to share in that moment. He would share that moment with us. So he'd make himself a very food and drink. So he shares the Paschal mystery with us. See, the Jews had their Paschal sacrifice. That was only a foreshadowing. We now have our Passover. Paul says, "Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed." And we have now the fulfillment that was foreshadowed in that Passover of the Jewish people. It's not merely a symbol. How do we know it's the real body and blood of the Lord and not merely a symbolic presentation? Well, we saw the answer to that in the outrage that Berengarius faced. He was clearly disregarding the living faith of the church. The faith of the church in the East and the West, right back to apostolic times, clearly affirmed by the great fathers of the church, is that the bread and wine really becomes the body and blood of the Lord. He has given us his own true body and blood in that wonderful expression of the Paschal mystery, that we may be nourished from it, that we may live in it and be part of it. There's another way in which we can reflect upon it, is to think about what a symbol is. See, a symbol is something that we call upon when we find it hard to grasp, something elusive, something difficult to define. We often invoke a symbol. If I ask you people, are we all united in saying that what we hold together as Australians is something precious, you'd all agree, I'm sure. If I then said, well, let's now work out what we hold together as Australians, we'll be here till next week, wouldn't we? It's so subtle, it's so rich, it's so complex, it's so difficult to define. There's so many different ways of looking at it and participating in it. We'd find it very, very difficult, if not impossible, to put it into words. But we're all agreed that there is something there, and it's very, very precious to us. So we have a symbol, the flag. So see how a symbol's invoked for something that's difficult to grasp. But was the death of Jesus difficult to grasp? No. It stared them in the face. They are terrified. They're overwhelmed. They know that he's going to die. They know this is probably the farewell meal. He needs no symbol to make them know his death. And he doesn't want to symbolize his death. He wants to share his death. He wants to share all that it means. He wants to make that final self-expression in our midst the nourishing of the whole world. There is the real meaning of Eucharistic celebration. If we're going to participate, we should, as the apostles, we're far more privileged, aren't we? They just had a dawning awareness. They later celebrated the Eucharist, no doubt with that full and vivid faith. But we have that full and vivid faith. We can understand what it means. We can rejoice and respond and participate in the Eucharist. Let's say something about the way in which theology has interpreted the Eucharist. That mosaic is an interesting one because it comes from that region near the Sea of Galilee. There's a little church that commemorated the meeting of Christ and his disciples, apostles, on the shore of the lake. That mosaic reflects a very early theology. See the fish, symbol of Christ, and the basket, clearly the Eucharist. They're affirming their faith in the Eucharist, Christ giving himself under the appearances of bread. So here are some of the thought forms that theologies use that help us to really depth the Eucharist. The Eucharist is a memorial. Do this in remembrance of me. That's a very special term in the scriptures. As I said, the Passover meal was a memorial. So for the Jewish people, there was a realism far beyond our human memorials. For the Jewish people in the Passover meal, they believed the living God who led those first Israelites out of slavery in Egypt was still the God of the people and was still blessing them, and all the blessings that the first people of the Exodus had had, they could share in too. But now that realism's far surpassed in the Eucharist, because it now is the Lord's own body and blood, the living Lord, gives himself as the nourishment and food of the world. It's a sacrifice. Sacrifice in our awareness has taken on a very hard sort of meaning. It's almost a punishing thing. The word sacrifice is a sort of a punishing, hard thing, isn't it? Sacrifice originally meant in the scriptures and among the peoples of the world who wanted to express their relationship with God, a sacred gift, taking the most precious thing in our world and giving it to God. If it was destroyed, that was not an act of punishment or destruction, really. It was an act of transfer into the possession of God. So the sacrifice of Jesus, because the Eucharist is called so often a sacrifice, if you've got that idea of sacrifice as some punishing thing, the overtones of a hard, demanding God come into the whole idea. Whereas if we think of it as a sacred gift, the perfect worship from the depths of our world made by the Saviour to the Father, after that there's no room for any other worship. That worship is the perfect worship of the whole of creation. That's the worship that we celebrate. It's a new covenant. We've seen how the old covenant was established in blood, now the new bond, the new communion. We have a union far greater than that of the people of the Old Testament, because the very blood of the Lord unites us to himself, unites us to our God. It's a foretaste of eternal life, a theme that very often has been developed in our Christian tradition. A banquet's one of the most wonderful moments in our experience. When you celebrate a great occasion, we gather, we have a meal together. So the prophets, as they tried to express the wonder of eternal life, spoke of the great banquet God would have on the mountain. All the people would gather at God's table. There they would sit down with God and celebrate together. And the Eucharist is a kind of anticipation of that final banquet of eternal life. We can link the Eucharist with our theme on the road to Emmaus. There's a very important little reflection, meditation, expressed there. As the church recalls that incident, the church recalls the celebration of the Eucharist. You can see the Eucharist being celebrated almost, and it shows how one the Eucharist of that time is with our celebration of the Eucharist. It's a matter of discipleship, that they are disciples. These disciples, they stand for us. The story is told not merely as an interesting story of something that happened after the resurrection. It's told for our instruction. It's told that we may enter into the same experience, that we may see ourselves as disciples, that we may come into the company of Jesus, and he will open the scriptures for us. So he's present in the scriptures. Remember that theme of the council? He is truly present in the scripture. If we're open to meeting him, letting him speak to us of the ways of God and the scriptures, our lives will be inspired and our hearts will burn within us, is said in that story. But then he's finally known in the breaking of the bread. The climax of the whole story is he's known in the breaking of the bread. We will meet our Saviour, and all the blessings he brought and all that he is the final achievement of God in our celebration of the Eucharist.